We have gathered here today on an emergency briefing basically to bring the cries of the innocent civilian and civil society in Bahrain to UN and indeed to ears of those who are willing to listen. We are extremely concerned of the violation which has been taking place in the recent months, and indeed the history of treatment of the civil society. We are here to voice those voiceless cries, both from the Sunni and the Shia community. And after the brief contribution from the floor here, we will be connecting yourself through the phone to human rights activists in Bahrain and the families of other human rights activists who are in prison. I would like to, first of all, ask Dr. Saeed Shehabi from Al-Haq movement, representative from the UK, to make his contribution. Dr. Shehabi.
Thank you very much. Welcome all to this briefing. And as my colleague, Dr. Massoud, just mentioned, we are here to highlight the fate of hundreds of people, probably thousands of people in Bahrain, as a result of their ongoing revolution. As we know, the revolution that started on the 14th of February has continued, despite the attacks on the people by the Saudi and other GCC forces who had crossed the border on the 16th of March, 1 month after the revolution was declared. Now, first of all, the revolution was the result of several factors, including the human rights abuses that had preceded it, but it has also led to more human rights abuses. And today, the situation of human rights in Bahrain is so bad that even the High Commissioner for Human Rights of the United Nations, Navi Pillay, has repeatedly called for investigation of abuses, has called for an end of attacks on civil liberties and on the basic rights of the city, of the citizens. Since 2006, the situation of human rights has escalated. In the negative sense, of course. The violations have escalated, more attacks on civil liberties were waged, and by the year 2007, 4 years ago, the use of torture has become rampant. And a glance at the Human Rights Watch report that was published last year in February would tell us that the year 2007 is seen as the year in which torture had returned as a wheel of repression and suppression of people's wealth. And the report also presented 20 testimonies, personal testimonies of torture victims. Now, also last year, the Islamic Commission for Human Rights issued also a similar report following a field trip by its representative to Bahrain earlier in the year, in which was titled Broken Promises. So the report was highlighting the promises given by the ruling family, but these promises were later subsequently broken. Now, the situation of human rights prior to 14th of February was dire, was bad, was very gloomy. We know in August last year, a massive campaign against political and human rights activists was waged, and more than 500 people were detained, and 25 of whom were subsequently charged with offenses relating to the overthrow of the regime, fabricating false news, relations with contacting foreign bodies, and so on. And of these 25 people, we have, I was one of them, who was implicated in the, in those charges. But we, I have also one of those who were detained, and he will later present his evidence as a person who was detained and tortured severely, and he was on release with the others on the 23rd of February, about 10 days after the emergence of the revolution. So he would give us his personal testimony. He was there for that period. I was not in the country, so I was not arrested. But after the 14th of February, the situation has become even worse. Less than a month, or within a month of the emergence of the revolution, the attacks by the ruling family and the Saudi forces in middle March resulted in a large number of deaths and thousands of, not up to a thousand of detentions. Thousands of people were sacked from their jobs, while hundreds were injured in the clashes, not in the clashes, but in the attacks, because there were no clashes between the people and the security forces. The attack on Pier Square was a watershed in the history of recent Bahrain and in the history of the revolution. And until today, the Saudi forces are still there, and we consider the country as being under occupation. Various calls have been made, either by President Obama or the British Prime Minister, or Catherine Ashton, the foreign affairs person of the EU. All of these people have called for restraint, have called for respect of human rights. In fact, I have a letter from the foreign minister of Britain. If anybody wants to see it, he would it clearly highlights their concern at the escalating human rights violations. So we are talking about a situation which needs a humanitarian approach, and this is why we are here today to highlight this situation: the use of live ammunition against peaceful demonstrators, the kidnapping of people from the streets, the use of death squads in the streets, wielding axes and swords and attacking people. These are all documented and filmed. We have plenty of footage showing these occurrences, these events. So we are facing a situation of extreme seriousness. And this is why we are here today, to highlight the fate of the Bahraini people, highlight the need for serious reforms, not cosmetic ones. We have seen cosmetic ones. We have seen a lot of propaganda. But what we haven't seen yet is real reform in Bahrain. Bahrain is ruled by a monarchy, a prime minister of which has been there in his post for the past 40 years, since 1971, and whose cabinet is filled by no less than two-thirds of the members of the ruling family. So you are not talking about real democracy in that sense. You are talking about autocracy, authoritarianism, corruption, and despotism. Now, in recent days, we know that the regime has attacked mosques, both the regime forces and the Saudi occupation forces, destroyed around 30 mosques and congregation homes. They have sacked more than 3,000 people from their jobs, detained at least 1,000 people, and the number is rising. They have charged 23 people with sedition and attempts to overthrow the regime, and fabricating false news and communicating with outside bodies. And we also saw how the doctors and nurses were detained. These events have only occurred in Bahrain, nowhere else, whereby the doctors were seized and tortured, as they gave evidence yesterday in their trial, doing their job, but the opposite, for doing their job. Because they did what they should do, they were detained, they were tortured. This yesterday they gave a lot of evidence, and Reuters published part of their testimonies in yesterday's dispatches. Now, what do we expect here? First of all, we expect that the High Commissioner for Human Rights, Navi Pillai, to send a fact-finding mission to Bahrain. They must assess. The United Nations must play a constructive and positive role in the situation. And we believe that a fact-finding mission is a must and is necessary in order to assess the claims that have been going around. We would like to refer Bahrain to the United Nations Security Council for war crimes. We believe there are war crimes. We have evidence to that. We are not claiming that, but we have it all in films. They were shown on TV, and we are keeping a large quantity of footage about war crimes. I mean, when you see somebody being killed by the police and another police shooting him and he falls to the ground, I think that would constitute a war crime. When you see people, a person lying on the street surrounded by security forces and soldiers and being beaten, when you see somebody being shot for bearing his chest and facing the tank and then a bullet coming to his head and falling dead, then that is not far from our crime. So we have evidence to that effect. We would also like Navi Pillai to investigate genocide. We believe that there is a degree of genocide of which my colleague may speak later, and also to investigate war crimes, as I have mentioned. We would also call on the special rapporteurs on torture, on arbitrary detention, on medical care, and on women and on children. These special rapporteurs should make, or are urged to make efforts to visit Bahrain and to assess the situation in these areas, because the situation must not be allowed to deteriorate further, because the more it deteriorates, the more agony is inflicted on peaceful people. We believe that the revolution in Bahrain is still there. It has suffered immense attacks, not just by the Bahrain forces, but by the forces of the GCC. And this is probably the only peaceful revolution which has been attacked in such a terrible way. And I think it is the duty of the human, the international community to take a responsible stand in order to minimize the misery and suffering of the people. These words are there for you to listen to, and hopefully they will make a difference to those people in jail who are tortured and who are enduring immense cruelty, and for the people at large who are imprisoned in the larger prison which is called Bahrain. Thank you very much.
Thank you. One of the reasons that has raised a lot of concern for us as a human rights organization is the systematic way that human rights defenders are being targeted in Bahrain. Systematically, they're being targeted. Their families have been targeted. Their families have been threatened with rape and abuse. And this is totally unacceptable. I actually feel very strongly that the UN needs to make a very, very firm stand against this sort of abuses, which are very clearly taking place, and it's been highlighted over and over. And especially when we see that, unlike Libya and elsewhere, the civil society in Bahrain have taken no military or action, any violent action. They have actually been going out in the streets in a very civil and peaceful way, and standing in front of not the bullets of just Bahraini security forces, but in front of the bullets of the Saudis and others. I mean, here is an invasion which is addressed against the civil society. Peaceful civil society is actually facing an invasion invited by their own government. And I really cannot remember ever that sort of situation ever before. But having said that, I would like to actually invite Rodney Shakespeare, who have been following the torture that is taking place in Bahrain, to say a few words.
Rodney. Press that button. Testing. Chair, one of the grounds which form the criminal charge of genocide is the deliberate destruction of the culture or religion of part or all of a people. When you destroy 26 mosques, maybe 30, as Saeed has mentioned, and there are at least another 30 other religious buildings, you cannot say that you were quelling a protest by doing so. You cannot say that you were stopping disorder by doing so. The evidence of the destruction of the mosques and of the religious buildings has one meaning and one meaning only, that you were in fact out to destroy the religion of a part or all of your population. And what is completely astonishing about this is that this organized deliberate destruction is in fact being done by one Muslim group against another. It's being done by a Sunni group against Shia. And you are talking, Chair, of unique situations. This, I think, may well be quite unique. But the point I'm making is that that particular evidence goes to genocide and can never be used in support of the case that it was for quelling a disorder. There is another feature of what is going on in Bahrain, and it is in fact the organized terrorization of the population. Some of this has been mentioned. It's done in various ways, including firing tear gas into houses at random at night, breaking into houses at random at night, and beating up people. And then, of course, there is the organized torture and the killing and the rest of it. But it is the widespread terrorization of the population and the evidence for that which goes to genocide and does not and cannot go to the suppressing of troublemakers in the street. Now, both those matters, the destruction of the religion and the terrorization, have recently come to the notice of the world in the charges which are being aimed at Ratko Mladic. And I listened to the judge reading out the summary of the 37-page indictment. And it's very clear in those charges that law has developed so that the destruction of a culture or a destruction of religion and the terrorization of a population, of a populace, most certainly are the crime of a genocide. There is a third aspect, here again just touched on by the chair and touched on by Saeed. And it seems to be almost unique. I don't think I would say that it goes to genocide, that's for others to judge. But it certainly goes to a unique and most extraordinary human rights violation. It's what you do when you stop medics from treating wounded people. You shoot them, you arrest them, you take the patients out of the beds, and a lot of those patients have not reappeared. And then you say no medic must even treat a wounded patient. Now, everybody knows that medics take a Hippocratic oath, which means that they will help anybody in distress, in medical distress. And if it's not the oath, it's part of the ethics of the courses by which they are trained and educated. And if it is not part of anyone's ethics of their course by which they're trained or educated, it is the part of the general behaviour of every straightforward, decent human being. You can't do much in life always, but if someone is wounded, well, you try and do your best. But the medics in Bahrain have been stopped. It's as simple as that. They have been arrested and tortured, whipped with rubber hoses, electrocuted with cattle prods, all because they treated wounded people. But it's actually worse than that. And there are two other aspects of the medical thing which I bring to your attention. Some of the nurses and doctors who've been released with their accounts of torture have stated that they were forced to confess that they had made the wounds worse. Now think for a moment. Who would gain anything by forcing nurses to say that the wounds have been worsened? And by the way, the method that's stated is the wounds that nurses have put their hands into the wound and pulled apart. Now, why should that be so? Why should the Bahraini authorities wish to have confessions saying that? Well, I can think of only one explanation, which is that the wounds are such of an extraordinary state and size that the only explanation for them has to be something like dum-dum bullets. You may know that an ordinary bullet will go straight through. Generally speaking, it can ricochet in various ways, but very often it will go straight through. It will kill you if it goes into a particular delicate organ, but it will go straight through. But with a dum-dum, all you have to do is you just nick the top. You put a cross on the top, or if you like, you just flatten the top. And the result is that when the bullet hits, it in fact suddenly disintegrates. And thus the hole it makes is not a hole like that. It is in fact a great massive injury like that. Now, I don't know. I've not seen the bullets. But that seems to me to be the only explanation for forcing those nurses to allegedly to have committed the widening and the worsening of those wounds. There's no other explanation for it. One last matter, Chair, which is I noticed that when was it 2 or 3 days ago when the nurses and doctors were in court. You can't make this up. But they were actually being charged. Now, here it comes. It's like 1984 in which all things stand on their heads or opposites. Those nurses and doctors were charged with not treating patients, having been stopped, having been tortured, being prevented. Even the Bahraini government seems to be having some recognition of a little bit of sanity and is now starting to try to find an explanation as to why the wounded haven't been treated. But it's now saying that they've arrested and they're charging the nurses with not treating those same nurses and doctors whom they in fact have prevented from treating. So, Chair, in summary, the grounds for genocide are now there. I think it's almost certain they are now well established in international law. Of course, it is another matter as to whether one can get a court of criminal justice with the jurisdiction to in fact arrest these torturers and killers. But don't forget that politics plays a part, that the case of Bahrain, through the offices of people here and elsewhere, the case is coming to the notice of the world. And even though there may not be a direct legal mechanism at the moment, politics can change anything. And I look forward to the time when every one of that very narrow clique who are committing genocide in Bahrain is arraigned before a criminal court of justice and that they all go down for at least 21 years. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. So I'd just like to highlight one thing, that the sectarianism that is unleashed in Bahrain is not coming from the people, is not coming from the civil society. They're going out, as a matter of fact, we will get in contact with over the phone with some victims, both Sunni and Shia. They went out together hand in hand and they said, we are not Sunni, we are not Shia, we are Bahrainis. You know, and this was very clearly the message that was being put out. The sectarianism comes from the government. And actually, they are the ones who are trying to turn this into sectarianism. They are the ones by going and destroying mosques of particular community are trying to unleash this negative aspect of sectarianism. And actually, the credit of the people of Bahrain is that they're not buying it. They're not going down that route. And I think this needs to be sort of recognized and applauded. I would like to sort of go to Jaffar Al-Hassab, who, as it was said, not only he represents Bahraini freedom movement, but he is himself a victim of torture. Brother Jaffar.
Hello and welcome to our session here in Geneva. This is the first time for me to speak in here, so forgive me if I am not willing to represent myself fully. I just want to brief my story when I came back last August to Bahrain on the 16th of August. They stopped me at the airport, and they took me in front of my daughters and my mom, and they took me to nowhere. I didn't know that place until 40 days after they transferred us to another jail, which was Al-Qal'a, an abasement, 2x2 cell. And it is dark because I was blindfolded all the time. When they tortured us, they don't allow us to, I mean, I didn't see who was torturing me, just because we are blindfolded. The way they treated us like they treated us like animals. We felt at that time that we are either to die or we are we are not a human. So anything they can do to us. They've tortured us severely. We were many people at that time. Especially our group, which is, as my colleague Saeed said, he was with us. He was with us in the same group, but he wasn't with us in the prison. But we were 23 people. I didn't know them until I see them in the second jail, which was in. Dry deck, they call it Al-Hawd Al-Jaf. But the torture I faced myself and the others also, because we showed the judge from the first trial, we showed the judge that we been treated very badly, tortured severely. But he just, because he is appointed by the king, and he can't do more than listen to us. And we are lucky that after a pressure from the human rights group and from the media, they showed. Maybe the judge showed that he should listen to us at the beginning. But after that, he refused to listen more than what we showed him and talked to him at the first session, at the first trial. We showed him that all the investigation took place under severely tortured. they've used electric shock to us. They applied to me in four places, in my ear, in my legs, in my back. They have electric machine, I don't know, but when you hear it, it's just to hear it, it is painful. And when they apply it to you, they just touch it to your body goes up, like you want to fly from the pain. Second type of torture, they used falaka, which is they hang prisoners between two things. Their body upside down. Their head, my head was down and my legs up, and they keep you for more than until you confess what they want you to confess, and they beat you with a rubber house, with severely in everywhere in your body, mainly in the feet, and also they left me standing for more than 23 days blindfolded and without sleep. So deprivation of sleep for more than 23 days. They just let me sit down when they bring food or when I pray. But all the time for more than 23 days, I was standing facing the wall, blindfolded, because I was seeing a lot of things in my mind.
Hallucinating.
And every time I move around the room, they come and slap me from there, and they position me again to the same area where I was. And also they they kept me for more than in solitary confinement for more than three months. I can't see no one, and also they didn't allow us to see our families for a very long time. And also they, beside all of this, everybody comes, they insulting us, and they insult us, and they it was so bad when I go back to that time. So this is just me, but there are many people, they are facing the same situation right now, and we can see a lot of people. Some of the figures are very old. They are old, and they are facing the same treatment at this time. I mean, torturing them, and we've heard that. Many people, they've used drill, but they didn't use it to us, but they are using it, drills, they are using ironing, they putting in the hot, let's say, sometimes they pour hot waters and cold water at the same time, I don't know. But it was a very bad experience we had. So this is, they call themselves democratics, and they are doing they treating a human unhuman. So I just want to stop in this, and hopefully.
Did they threaten you with rape?
Yes, they sexually abuse. They come, and if you don't confess, we're going to rape you. And it happens to others. Thank God they didn't do it for me. And thank you for your listening.
Thank you very much.
It is always very traumatic just listening to people who have been tortured. But what is really worrying, this is not just individuals being tortured, there is a systematic torturing taking place. a sort of torturing. And those who are being tortured are actually looking to international community to actually stop this. And it is within the power of international community to stop this. You know, Bahrain does need the international community. Bahrain would be influenced by international community. But I think there is no political will, unfortunately. And we need to sort of create that political will that will move things forward. We have two more contributions. I'm conscious that I want to go to sort of open the floor. But before that, I would like to sort of, on the phone, we have Rashid Al-Buflasa, who... Buflasa, sorry, excuse my pronunciation, who is Muhammad's brother, who was arrested almost at the beginning of this whole conflict, in mid-February. He is from the Sunni community background, although that doesn't make any difference, but just for your background. I've got him on the phone, and I would like to sort of... Hello? Sorry, I just... put. Hello, can you hear me?
Hello?
Yes,
I can hear you.
Yeah, would you like to sort of explain the circumstances of your brother's arrest?
Then I fly to Bahrain and I meet Muhammad.
Well, thank you, Rashid. We all are very sympathetic to what your family and many others are going through. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Sorry.
This is, of course, sorry, shall I say?
Yes.
This is the brother of Muhammad Al-Buflasa. Muhammad Al-Buflasa is, I think he works for the military, for the defense force, and he came to the roundabout right at the beginning days in February, and he gave a speech supporting the people. He's a Sunni, he's a liberal person, and after leaving the roundabout, he has never been seen after that, and this is his brother giving the story because he is still in detention and he is not taken to court yet because they keep changing the accusations and the charges. So this is just a Sunni person to show that the situation is not as the government would like to do it, that it is a sectarian war. There is no sectarianism, no sectarian conflict as such. It is the government which is trying to show it. This is just one other example. The other example, of course, is Ibrahim Sharif, who is the another more senior figure of the opposition. He is a liberal Sunni figure, and he has been now he is being charged with our group, the 23, of attempting to overthrow the regime and so on. He has been severely tortured like the others. So this is just to make you, to put you in the picture.
I think also it's really important to bear in mind that the case that we just heard, the fact that, you know, failure of due process, there is no due process taking place. And that failure has actually created a huge frustration within the community because there's no due process. International sort of pressures are really, in comparison to what is taking place, are really not justifiable, and I think they're very mild. And there should be Mr. Saeed Shehabi, Dr. Shehabi, talked about all international community have been saying things, but that's as far as it goes. There is no action. It's almost like saying that, you know, Bahrainis have been told that we're going to be tough with our words, but we're not going to be beyond that. And unfortunately, that is the perception that is exists within the Bahraini civil society. We are just waiting for... We are actually waiting to talk to Nabil Raja, but he's going to the voicemail. So in that case, I will open up the question and answer. We will come back to him because... Nabil is probably one of the most prominent human rights activists and who is still out of jail. He's very brave, and he's actually been, he could enlighten us later on. But in the meantime, would anybody like to raise any question? Please.
Hi, I'm Oliver Freeman, an intern at Human Rights Watch. As such, I'm not speaking on behalf of the organisation. Nevertheless, I have a question for Jaffar. You said that you were arrested last August, some 6 months before the protests in Bahrain took place. And as such, you know, did not form part of the context of the movement. I was just wondering What charges were you detained for exactly? What reasons were given to you for your detention? Thank you.
Yes, thank you. They didn't give us a true charges. They see me, I live in the UK, and they see me protesting every time there's any issue in Bahrain. If we have prisoners, or if we talking about the torture in Bahrain, and they see me in the media that I am protesting, but it seems that I was not lucky at that time That's why they arrested me. They don't have a solid, let's say, accusation against me. And the accusation put into each of us, the 25 people that overthrew, I mean, they plan to, they, we are as a terrorist group planning to overthrow the government, spreading and also spreading rumors and false news against the government and the regime. So this is the whole accusation.
The situation in Bahrain, of course, as has been highlighted, has not only not become better, but is constantly deteriorating. We have around 1,000 detainees still in prison, and I think it's very important to have events like these to highlight the situation in the country. One of the things that I would like to highlight, and I hope that people on the panel will agree with me, is that one of the things that we've been facing a lot when talking to people at the UN is the fact that there is a political problem when dealing with Bahrain, as in referring to Bahrain during the Human Rights Council. And so one of the things that I'm proposing starting today is that a lot of countries said that they were very aware of the human rights violations in Bahrain, but because of the political situation were unable to pinpoint it. So we are here to ask people, especially member states, to bring up Bahrain under item 4 next week. And I think this is the perfect opportunity to see whether what we have been told is truth about these countries being really aware of the situation in Bahrain and willing to speak up, and that it's only the political situation within the Human Rights Council that this allows them from speaking out about Bahrain specifically. So we'll be waiting for next week to see if these member states actually do come up and speak out against about Bahrain or what's happening in Bahrain under item 4. Thank you.
So what? I don't understand. Why should Bahrain be brought under item 4?
Because it's a perfect opportunity to speak about the situation in Bahrain within the Human Rights Council.
Thank you. Sorry, do you want to say something?
Two questions. One to the rest of the panel. There are specific features of the torture in Bahrain. Is it correct to say that they all stem from the imperial? There are specific features about torture in Bahrain. Is it correct to say that they all stem from the techniques introduced into Bahrain by Colonel Ian Henderson, a British officer? And my question down for Mariam down there, could you explain just a little more what you meant by the political difficulties that they have? I think it would be helpful if you could spell that out a bit more.
Yeah, sure. The political difficulty in the sense that it's really difficult for Bahrain as being part of the region that it is, namely the GCC, the influence of other countries in that region, and having close allies which have a lot of clout with a lot of countries. That makes it difficult to introduce things like a resolution or a special session on Bahrain, which they have done for other countries.
Now, are you saying, putting it bluntly, that shall we say, to take a country, that the United States' influence is stopping this coming? I mean, what countries are essentially putting the pressure on and stopping this matter coming to light? And why should they do so?
Well, I can't really put all the blame on one country right now.
Several countries?
Let's leave it at that. But we are definitely seeing situation of double standards in which countries there are special sessions on and which countries there will be resolutions on. But I am saying that the perfect opportunity to bring the situation of Bahrain will be under item 4 next week. And we're hoping that that's what we're going to see, is member countries actually engaging and speaking about Bahrain under item 4.
I think when you look at what is happening, the way that inactivity of challenging the human rights abuses which are systematically taking place in Bahrain, then one has to have a look at the alternatives. The other alternative is that, you know, international community doesn't care about what's happening in the world, which doesn't seem to be the case. And, you know, then it comes to the issue of, you know, is somebody actually stopping it? Or is it lack of will by the international community as a whole? And I don't know which one is worse, but the reality is that we need to sort of give voice to the people of Bahrain. I think people in Bahrain have been extremely patient. They've been extremely sort of civil as a civil society. They have not taken any acts of violence, and therefore they actually need to be supported much more by international community and civil society internationally than they have been. And I think this is something that we need to all go out and actually do extra work to make sure that something is being done. And the other aspect is that, you know, I think we need to sort of look at the whole situation of Bahrain, not just over recent months, but even prior to that, the way that minority rights have been denied to the majority, I mean, if I may use the term, that the majority are becoming a minority and are being sort of systematically put under pressure, as Rodney said, and also the way that the government is trying to use this and turn it into a conflict, it's actually something that international community need to sort of say is enough. We, the Bahrainis, see themselves as united, and they should not be allowed to be manipulated into this conflict, which will be very damaging for not for Bahrain, but even for the whole region. It seems that we're having difficulty getting hold of Nabil, but
I was going to ask Miriam if she can say something about her father. What's happening to him?
Yeah. Yes.
Who is he and where is he now?
As a human rights activist, I usually don't make it personal, but okay. My father is a prominent human rights defender. He was the former regional director of Frontline Defenders, which is based in Dublin, Ireland. He recently resigned his post at Frontline Defenders to engage in the protests in Bahrain to create awareness about what it meant to have human rights, what it meant to demand them, and so on. He was arrested by the Bahraini authorities. He was, upon arrest, beaten unconscious and taken away with two of my brothers-in-law. For several weeks after that, we had no idea of where he was or what he was being subjected to. When he was finally put on military trial with 20 other people in Bahrain, my family was finally able to see him and speak to him. He had four fractures in his face. He had to undergo major surgery because of the treatment that he had been subjected to. He said that his time at the hospital right after the surgery was the worst time for him throughout his detention. Namely because of how he was treated. He was blindfolded right after surgery. So he came to consciousness while being blindfolded. And he was blindfolded for the whole period that he was kept in the hospital. Given this one example, of course, I usually don't like bringing up my father's case because it is not something that's limited to my family. I have five family members in prison today. This is something that is very familiar to hundreds of families in Bahrain. And that's why, as in my capacity working for the Bahrain Center for Human Rights, we concentrate on working on all these cases rather than the cases of our families. So I really think that this highlights, I mean, the way that they've treated the prominent human rights defenders definitely highlights how they would treat other people who are also in detention. Thank you.
Thank you. I think the other point that, you know, it's obviously very clear, I was saying earlier on that what is really so disheartening is the way that human rights defenders are being targeted forefront of everything, you know, long before any other arrest, the first arrest for human rights defenders. And in many cases, very clearly, just because they are defending human rights. And from that point of view, I think we need to be outraged by that, more so, not on the basis of family, but on the basis of those who are being targeted. Really, let us do what is required of us. Bahrain needs your support. The innocent people in Bahrain, men, women, children, teachers, lecturers, aid workers, you know, human rights defenders, doctors, nurses, they all need our help. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
really let us do what is required of us. Bahrain needs your support. The innocent people in Bahrain, men, women, children, teachers, lecturers, aid workers, human rights defenders, doctors, nurses, they all need our help. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.